You're listening in on an animated discussion about Batman the Animated Series with two experts in their fields. I'm Joshua Unruh, superhero scholar.
And I'm Caleb Masters, your friendly neighborhood film critic extraordinaire from thecinemetropolis.com. And today, we'll be discussing Season 2, Episode 12 of Batman the Animated Series, The Lion and the Unicorn. Joshua, I just have to ask a question I'm going to throw out there. What the hell is this title card?
Okay, so interestingly, I kind of like it.
Really? Wait, seriously.
Now, I'm going to explain to you why.
Please do, because I looked at it, I was like, this is the laziest freaking title card that tells me nothing. But okay, go ahead.
Okay, I think it tells us a little bit about the episode. It maybe doesn't tell us the biggest thing about the episode, but it's like, it gets about 60 or 70% there for me because it is very, very like old Britannia, right?
Yep.
Like the font is very kind of obviously ye olde pub,
right,
kind of thing.
Right.
And we've got silhouettes of Big Ben and Buckingham Palace. So we know we're doing something very English, which is 100% true, right?
Yep. Oh, no.
Accurate. It's centered on London, which is very cool. The thing that we are not told in the title card that I feel like would have been useful to know somehow is that London is itself the thing that is in great danger. You know, we're not just in London. London is held hostage.
Correct.
Now, if they had gotten that into this title card, I would have declared it amazing, honestly, because I really like what they do with it, but it doesn't go far enough.
It's okay. I respect what you're saying here. I hear you. I don't think you're wrong, but I also feel like, with that said, because it does tell us about London, so I agree. But I'm just going to throw this out there. I definitely could have made this in Photoshop and in like 30 minutes.
Well, I mean, that's true. It's not complicated. Like it is not a complicated piece. But you know, the last time that we complained about this, well, maybe not the last time, but the last time that really jumps to my mind is when we talked about the Maxi Zeus episode.
Oh,
where
yeah.
It was like, this is a really lazy title card. And it also didn't really tell us what we needed to know about the episode. So I don't want to start grading these on complexity because, you know, some of our favorite ones have actually been really simple.
Really simple. Yep.
Like Joker and a kid in silhouette in front of a carnival.
Right. Right.
You know, like a lot of them are very, we even really liked the title card for Baby Doll on its own merits.
Right.
Pretty simple.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that's
so
fair. That's fair.
I'm going to push back against complexity, but I get you. I mean, like I really liked how English this thing was,
right?
Because legit, this episode is super duper English.
Oh no, it's the definition of English. In fact, I thought I should crack open some English tea before I started watching the episode.
It really is. And so if they had just given me some suggestion that it was London itself that was in danger and not just the setting, I really think it would have been very strong personally.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, and that, you know, again, it's not like it ruins the episode or anything. I thought it was a weird choice, and my reaction was, wow. Okay, initial reaction, what the hell is this? Getting it's about Alfred, okay. And then, of course, I look up, and then I Googled The Lion, the Unicorn, like what it actually is, and I was like, oh, okay. Maybe this is because I'm not educated. I didn't actually know that was a London thing for the UK somehow.
Yes.
So I was like, okay, all this is making way more sense. So it's not like total disaster, but it was just funny. My knee-jerk reaction was, what is this? you know, I think it does set the stage for the episode really well. And we get a feel that it's going to be an Alfred-centric episode pretty quickly.
Yes.
I think this kind of sets that expectation.
I really like that opening scene too, because it could have gone some different ways. Like if this had turned into a different episode, the beginning would still work and give us a really kind of amazing family moment, you know, of the Bat family. I really liked that.
I knew you would like this. The scene where Dick was doing some gymnastics and working out. I was like, Joshua's going to love this. I loved it too. Actually, it was great. It was like, hey, they're just hanging out in the Batcave for fun, and they're all having fun. It's a nice moment.
It's their, I mean, for better or worse, and again, I tend to frame this as better, the Batcave is kind of the family space. Like, this is where we are most ourselves and doing our most important work, and Dick is down there practicing and enjoying himself, like having fun, and I think the place where we could kind of pin that this was going to be an Alfred moment is how much Alfred parenting Batman yes. and Robin we get.
Yep.
And I really like that. And I especially like when Alfred and Robin are gently, you know, prodding one another. And before Batman leaves, you get a smile. Like, these are my people. I loved this very, very much. And we could stand to have more of that in the world of big media Batman.
Yeah. 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 I mean, a little bit of family love. I know the Bat family is certainly not on the big screen as much or at all, unless you count Batman and Robin. But this was a nice moment. This was a really nice moment. And I like how you compare it to the shared space. So it's like basically the family room. Instead of going to the actual family room or living room, whatever you call it in your household, this is the Bat Cave. The Bat Cave is the living room of the Wayne Manor. That's pretty fantastic.
I think it is, too. And I think that's okay. I mean, especially in this kind of in-between space that isn't where the car is, but it's close. And it isn't where the computer is, but it's close. And, you know, like, it's... Yeah, I could go on about that. And in fact, the only big media, like the only Batman movie I need to see is one that actually centers the Bat family. Every other idea can just go right in the garbage as of 2019. So more of this on the big screen, Bat family show, Bat family movie. Now let's actually talk about Alfred.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Moving on. Yes, please. Joshua. So Alfred has been, the MI6 history is not lost on me. I've seen it in other media. I know the Batman, not the Batman. Hold on. Sorry. Was it Beware the Batman? What was the 3D?
Beware the Batman.
Yeah,
yes,
the 3D animated show. They actually played that up pretty heavily, that was his kind of his background. But I would like for you to maybe enlighten me a little bit more, and certainly the listeners, like, what can you tell us about Alfred's background and how that plays into this episode?
So Alfred's background is a moving target, honestly. Like, we've got, you know, nearly 80 years of Batman, and almost all of that had some form of Alfred in it. Not right from jump, but very early we had an Alfred figure. It actually changed from a more comical Alfred into one we would recognize now. Like, Alfred Beedle became Alfred Pennyworth, and we kind of put him in a different space. And at the point that he changed in the comics to Pennyworth, he got a little bit of a background that made sense for a guy who was going to support Batman. For instance, he had a background in the theater. He was an actor. And it was the family business that was butlering, right? Mm-hmm. This has changed also, by the way, when we wanted him to be more of a father figure for Bruce, right?
Right.
But originally, he inherited the position of Wayne Butler from his father. And actually came to the manor after Bruce and Dick had got together and were fighting crime as Batman and Robin. And so he came in after Dick at a certain point Batman's history. But part of that is he's an actor, so he knows, like, stage makeup, and he knows how to pretend to be other people. And further back from that, he was actually part of the resistance during World War II, because that used to make sense in the sliding time scale of superhero comics, right? So he was a field medic and a freedom fighter, like, for the French. He was an Englishman who was working with the French during World War II, like, on French soil. So now he also has combat experience and can stitch Batman and Robin up when we move into an era of stories where that becomes a thing we care about.
Man, Joshua, it's like he's made to be Batman's butler. You know what I mean? Like, it made to be Batman's right-hand man, sort of. You know what I mean? He's got combat experience. He's got the spy experience. So, like you said, the theatrical side of the makeup, the costumes, and all that. Man, yeah. God, perfect. Perfect backstory.
Now, we move forward in time a little bit, right? And we lose World War II because that stops making sense with real time,
right?
And we enter into a place where, when he was a younger man, it would be the Cold War.
Of course.
You know, and that's the point where we start seeing him shift out of combat and into more of a, like, attache, you know, kind of situation, which basically means a not entirely secret agent. Like, that's really what that means, you know. I'm doing spy stuff. I really, really like John le Carre novels, so I have some feelings about Alfred as attaché. I really like it. And it's a place that you can sandwich in some combat medic expertise if that's a thing that you really want to. Like, every now and then he had to stitch some people up. And you usually go into that service from a military service, so you can get away with him as a non-wartime, you know, member of some part of the English military where he was a medic. And he goes from that into diplomatic things, which really means spying, you know. Most recently, some less than stellar choices have been made in this area, in my opinion. Moving into Beware the Batman and also into Gotham, he becomes like James Bond,
yes.
Only old.
Yes.
And he's going to be part of Batman's training, like part of Bruce Wayne's training. And I think that's terrible. Like, it's kind of... Because I agree with you that with some of that older stuff, it felt like he was made to be Batman's butler. But at the same time, it was also sort of separate stuff that felt like a life.
Right.
You know, like right. I was in the army when it made sense to be in the army. Mm. I had a certain set of skills and I still wanted to serve my country. So I became a diplomatic attache. But my dream had always been the theater. So when I retired from that, I went to the theater. But my father's dying wish brought me into this place that I did not want to be in and discovered that it is actually the perfect place for me to be.
Right.
And now I am happy and it's wonderful. That feels like a life, you know?
Yes. Yep.
I'm James Bond, but old. So I'm going to become the butler to the guy that will be the Batman is the laziest version of that you could think of.
Well, he's James Bond where he's actually got a plan, like a retirement plan outside of, you know, just dying or getting old or whatnot. That's fine.
I don't love it. And it's apparently taken so much hold that there is going to be an entire show titled Pennyworth that is about Alfred as James Bond. And guys, who cares? Who wants this?
I was actually about to pose the same question. I'm just, why? Why? Do people really want that spinoff show? There's a million Batman spinoffs they could do, and they pick that one? I don't know.
They could just do a Bat Family show, frankly, and have an amazing sort of very competent fatherly Alfred. I don't know, like the one we get in this episode. That would be so much more interesting to me. Like an intergenerational Bat Family story? Come on. But instead, we're going to go watch Alfred be James Bond. I don't think it's a good idea for the character. I don't think it supports better world building. And I feel like it's the laziest take for Alfred as Batman's butler. And then you retroactively try and force people to be more interested in it than they ought to be. I don't know. I don't like it. This is a much better take, in my opinion.
No, I agree. I don't feel like I need a ton of Alfred backstory. I'll be honest. I mean, it's fair.
He's no, a character I agree. Love. I agree
we
with
love
that.
Him, so getting some details is fine, but or leaving it somewhat ambiguous is great. I certainly don't want a whole spinoff show. And I think honestly, what we get in this episode is about as much as I care to know about Alfred. To be honest,
100%. I also agree with that. It explains a certain level of competency, right?
Right.
It puts him as a person who could, in some ways, keep up with Bruce Wayne, right? Like, we don't expect him to jump from rooftop to rooftop, but why is he so good
right.
at organizing information? Why is Batman's intelligence so good? Well, I have a suggestion. It's because a friggin' intelligence officer is his butler.
Yep.
I love that. But, like, it fills in enough story space without going oversized. Like outsizing Alfred's overall capabilities.
Well, it's up to the viewers or the readers, if you're comic book or watch, you know, it's up to us to determine with our imagination, like headcanon. Okay, well, Alfred was a secret agent. Cool. And like, that's all we need from the story perspective. And if we want to imagine stories or whatnot, I think that's fine. I just don't think that needs to be visualized for the story. I don't think that enhances it in any way, really.
I don't need 1,000 Alfred secret agent stories.
No,
I don't.
No.
And if I did need that show, I would want it to be like George Smiley from the John le Carre novels, who's like riding a desk, running things. You know, he's not the one in the field. He's the one managing the field, because that also makes a certain amount of sense for the guy that will be Batman's butler. I don't want that. But if I had to have it, that's more interesting than him actually running around punching dudes anyway.
Yeah. Well, aside from that note, one thing I want to mention, I think this got acknowledged in our last episode when we talked about Baby Doll. It really does feel like we're getting pretty close to the end of the line for Batman the Animated Series. It seems like they are now going. So we've gone through their A-list, their B-list, and their C-list rogues gallery. We've gone to more of the deep cut villains. We've had villains who've been invented for the show, most of them pretty good, some of them not so great. And now it's like, okay, well, we haven't told an Alfred story yet. We've done how many, 50 or 60 of these episodes now? We haven't told Alfred's story. So yeah, let's go ahead and do an Alfred story. And as I mentioned in our last episode, it reminds me a lot of the end of the X-Men, the animated series run, where they start telling very specific stories about very specific questions. Like, it's less team oriented and then more about the individual subplots of different characters. And, yeah. And this is still, of course, features Batman. It still features the team, but it definitely feels like, oh, we're going really deep into the well. We're getting an Alfred episode where Batman's, I mean, he's obviously a key player, but not necessarily the featured character.
I think you're right in another way with this episode, because we repurpose a villain from an older episode that we didn't really need to have again.
Right.
But she makes sense here. So, hi, welcome back, Red Claw.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, because it does give a little more weight to what's going on in this episode that we have seen Red Claw already, and we don't have to start over explaining why this person is very dangerous. Yep. We have a whole episode or two episodes for that.
That's good storytelling. It's a good use of like storytelling for the showrunners. Like, hey, why create a new villain when we've got this other kind of throwaway villain that is also very tied to Cold War era villainy that can work just as
in
easily.
The name.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Red Claw in an Eastern European accent is doing Cold War things that honestly made a lot more sense in 1996 than they do now.
Correct.
But anyway.
At the time, it seemed appropriate.
They make different sense now. Let's say it like that.
Yeah. Fair enough. But yeah, I mean, I thought it was, this was fun.
Overall, I really like this episode myself. I like exactly this much Alfred backstory, like you were saying. I like how English it is.
Yes.
Sometimes almost to a cartoonish level. Like I have in my notes, did Mary Poppins loan some chimney sweeps out as henchmen?
Yes. I mean, it does feel like that, right? Like it is the most British version of British you could come up with in a cartoon.
But like Alfred's friend apologizing for getting him kidnapped and Alfred being like, well, of course, dear boy. I love all that.
Everything's
that
highly, stuff is great. Everyone's highly polite and all that stuff. Yeah, no, it's fun. It's good fun. Okay, so I want to make a note here, and I don't know if you had a similar experience. So I have the Blu-rays. We've talked about this, about the Blu-rays when they came out. And most of the time, the Blu-rays look outstanding. Okay, so everything looks great. And then we get to the London scene. And all of a sudden, there is a very, looks like a, like when he's in London, you get the street lamps lit up. There's like a very, I thought it was a soft focus filter over the camera.
Oh.
I could have been wrong. I could be totally wrong. I don't know did you notice something somewhere?
I didn't notice it, but I kind of now hope they did that because, you know, London fog, right?
Right. Exactly. That was what I thought. But what's interesting is, later in the episode, it looks like the transfer is just bad. There's like a lot of bad like things that aren't in the other episodes, like black spots popping on the screen. I was like, oh, so maybe that was unintentionally great and wasn't part of it. I don't know. I'd love to do a little more research into this specific episode because I thought it was a style decision. But when I got to the end, I was like, wait, maybe this was just a really poor transfer and they had to go dig up. They could never find like the original files
maybe.
Or something because it definitely didn't look like the other episodes in the series. I don't know if any of you other Blu-ray watchers out there noticed the same thing with this episode. If you do, please feel free to tweet at us because I would love to hear
what
you thought.
I didn't really notice. Still, I'm streaming from DC Universe right now and I didn't really notice, but that, you know, is not necessarily, I'm also taking notes and doing all kinds of other things, so I could have just missed it.
But I definitely know the London fog. That's really what I thought. I was like, oh, it's like a soft focus, you know, to kind of make it feel a little more like dreamlike,
so strong,
like a foggy night and everything. You know, a little bit of like the with a Werewolf in London side of sort of vibe. And then when it didn't go away, I was like, oh, maybe not.
So overall, tell me, I think you don't love this episode as much as me, but you like that it's very English.
Yes.
Here's another thing I really like, and I feel like you're going to come along with me on this. Globetrotting Batman and Robin is always good.
Oh, yeah.
And it's also interesting to get it without Ra's.
Yes. Okay. So globetrotting without Ra's, it certainly feels different because this is, I mean, obviously we're talking about nuclear bombs and weapons here, so I shouldn't say the stakes are lower, but like the stakes feel different. Okay.
Yes.
Hey, we're trying to stop missiles from firing versus a dude who wants to wipe out human existence so he can rebuild the world in his image. You know, like that, there's a little difference there. And I found the change in tone here to be really refreshing.
Yes. It's a change in tone, both sort of at stakes level. And I think we also get that sort of family note played throughout a lot of the episode, because I really liked Dick worrying about Alfred and being wrong about the way he should be worried about Alfred because he didn't know anything about Alfred's background. You know, like Dick worrying how scared Alfred would be and Bruce being like, I don't think so, little brother, you know,
right,
is a really good beat. I really liked that. it's nice to see them care about each other like people, but it's also nice to see Bruce go, you are underestimating him.
Yes. Yeah. Wholeheartedly agree. Yeah. Well, and that's, I think that's kind of meant to be talking to the audience a little bit too there, speaking to the audience, because it's really easy for us to forget how skilled Alfred is and how important he is and how competent he is and how well he can take care of himself. You know what I mean? So Batman telling that to Robin, I think, is a great way to remind the audience as well. Like, hey, listen, he's going to be okay. He's a big boy. Trust me.
I mean, he's in danger. Don't get me wrong. But, you know, you're worried about him for the wrong, you know, sort of the wrong reasons,
right.
I guess, is really, it's a good take. Speaking of more amazing Batman and Robin fun, how amazing was their infiltration of that castle?
Oh my God, it was so much fun. So much fun.
The teamwork is so strong.
Yeah, no, I thought it was super strong teamwork. Again, the banter's fun. And I think it was just the animation, the way they kind of decided to draw it and how they execute the infiltration, I thought overall was pretty good. It was pretty good. It was fun. And that's, again, as much as the stakes in this episode feel like that of a spy movie, I also found the buddy cop angle with Batman and Robin to be especially strong in this episode. Overall, I mean, going back to that very first scene that we talked about earlier.
Oh, yeah, definitely. It makes me feel like this is two in a row that are actual Batman and Robin adventures that start with the Batman and Robin adventures opening theme.
Yeah, it actually fits this one, unlike certain other episodes.
And for the first time, I mean, honestly, I've loved Robin in other episodes, obviously, but for the first time, I kind of had a moment where I was like, I feel like this show missed an opportunity to do an actual Batman and Robin show.
Right, right, right.
You know, we're going to get that with the redesign and with Tim Drake, but I just started spinning all these really interesting thoughts about what BTAS as a Batman and Robin show from Jump would have looked like. And I'm intrigued.
Yeah, no, well, let's just see how the rest of the episodes turn out, because you're right. This is what, okay, whenever you say
you
the adventures
point,
of Batman, whenever you say the adventures of Batman and Robin, which technically they've been saying has been happening for a while, but this is what I imagined versus some of the other episodes that are technically under that banner that hardly have Robin in them at all. It's just very strange.
No, I agree. That's why I say this is the one that made me go, oh, we missed an opportunity.
This is what this was supposed to be like. Okay.
Yeah. And it was really cool. So I love that. I love Batman and Robin together. I love infiltrating the castle. I think Red Claw really works in this episode. Like, we've explained already why she has all these men at her disposal. And let me tell you something. Her speech, like her Ransom London speech,
right,
was good.
Hey man, Cold War era goodness right there. And actually, I think the Cold War angle fits way stronger here with the Red Claw than it did in the Cat in the Claw, right? Like, it's
yes, definitely.
Felt like an eco. She was like kind of like an eco terrorist of some sort. Like, this makes way more sense to me.
Yeah, definitely. And just, yeah, that whole, you know, you have survived plagues and armies, but God save the queen. I was just like, that's a good speech.
That's a good speech.
I am now worried.
Yeah. So, hats off to the writing team for this one. Great great storytelling, using a pre-established Cold War era villain to fill the needs of this particular story, I think was a great choice. And they wrote to that strength. Well, Joshua, let's go ahead and close out the show, as always, with some alternate media recommendations. Mine aren't super interesting, so if it's all right, I'm going to start this one off, because
yeah,
I think yours
yeah.
are going to be better than mine.
Start us with a low point. No, I'm kidding.
Well, I'm just saying, because I was struggling with this one, so I just went with the obvious Bond reading, and so I was like, what are two of the most Cold War stories told in the James Bond films? And what,
sure.
what I got is Octopussy, starring Roger Moore, and The Living Daylight, starring Timothy Dalton. And the reason being, because both of these actually feature Russians as the bad guys.
Sure.
Oftentimes in the Bond films, they feature fictitious organizations or like total third party contractors. These are people who are, this is more like the Rocky IV style. Like, no, very clearly we're talking about Russia right now. Like, so, and Rocky IV, I think, could be another great recommendation. I think you made that one a few episodes ago, but I'll throw it out there too. How about you? What you got?
All right. I'm actually going to go back to the same year that this episode came out. Are you ready for 1996's Broken Arrow?
Oh my God. What?
Well, we're talking about stolen nuclear weapons.
Okay. Okay.
Right?
Yes.
Right? It's not Russians, but it is stolen nuclear weapons. And while this was doing a very Cold War thing with nuclear weapons, that this one was actually doing a much more, almost a very prescient take on terrorists and stealing nuclear weapons. Also, friends, it is directed by John Woo.
Whoa.
And it is fantastic.
Guys,
John Travolta, Christian Slater, directed by John Woo. Love it. Cannot get enough of it. Highly recommend.
That is the most 90s-tastic 80s style film if I've ever heard one. Because John Woo is like a throwback to like a different era of action filmmaking. But those people are 90s stars. So yes, 100% second that recommendation.
About wraps up this animated discussion. Caleb, where can people go to continue the conversation with you?
Well, Joshua, you can always find me on Twitter talking about film, television, video games, and all sorts of other pop culture goodness at C Masters Talk. That's letter C Masters Talk. I'm also the editor in chief and film critic at the Cinematropolis, and we publish these in-depth essays on all types of different films, oftentimes including science fiction and superhero films, all the stuff you'd want to read about. And you can find all these articles at thecinematropolis.com. Joshua, what about you?
I'm also most active on Twitter, where you can find me easily enough at Joshua Unruh. And remember that an animated discussion is a Pulp Diction Productions program and is 100% supported by listeners like you. To find out how you can keep this and our other shows in production, check out patreon.com/pulpdictionproductions.
Well, in our next episode, I think we're going to take another trip back in time. This time we'll be discussing Season 2, Episode 13, Showdown.
Until next time, we'll see you back here. Same bat time, same bat channel.